other printmaking processes which had been in use for centuries, lithography was still a new and exciting discovery in the early 1800s. It was invented in Germany by Alois Senefelder in the late 1790s and was based on the simple principle that grease and water don't mix. Senefelder discovered that it was possible to produce prints by using a greasy crayon to draw or write on a polished piece of Bavarian limestone. The stone was then repeatedly wet, inked, and run through a printing press to create multiple impressions of the original design. The name lithography literally means writing on stone. Lithography had great potential for producing large numbers of prints quickly, easily, and inexpensively, but knowledge of the new process spread slowly. Senefelder finally published a manual explaining his process in 1817, 20 years after its invention. The manual was quickly translated into French and English and had an immediate impact. The first known American lithograph, this modest view of a mill on a river by the portrait painter Bass Otis, was published in Philadelphia in July 1819 in the Analectic Magazine, accompanying a note on lithography by Judge Thomas Cooper, professor of chemistry at the University of Pennsylvania. Although Bass Otis was an artist, this first American lithograph is primarily of technical rather than artistic interest. Meanwhile, other pioneer American lithographers had been learning about the process in Europe. Anthony Imbert, originally a French naval officer, is said to have learned drawing and painting as well as lithography while a prisoner of war in England. Isaac Doolittle, a young man from New Haven, Connecticut, learned the process while a prisoner of war in France, where he also learned the French language and a great deal about steam navigation. While in France, Doolittle made the acquaintance of William Armand Barnett, the son of the American consul, who shared Doolittle's interest in steamboats. Apparently, he also shared Doolittle's interest in lithography, because in 1821, the pair opened the first commercial lithography shop in America at 23 Lumber Street in New York City. Two of their earliest lithographs appeared in 1822 in the Journal of Science and Arts, which was published in New Haven and edited by Benjamin Silliman, a professor of chemistry at Yale College. And just this afternoon, I discovered in some letters in the Historical Society of Pennsylvania that Silliman was actually acquainted with Barnett's father, the American consul in Paris. The first of these early Barnett and Doolittle prints is a view of Smith's coal mine in Luzerne County, Pennsylvania. Like Bass Otis's earlier lithograph in the Analectic magazine, the print has little artistic merit and is chiefly of interest as an example of the new technique. Although the magazine included a note about lithography, the prints themselves served as illustrations to an article about coal mining. A second print, Coal Mine of Troy near Saint-Étienne, was drawn by J. Milbert, possibly Jacques Gerard Milbert, and clearly an artist of some talent. The quality of the second print is so superior to the first that it seems likely that Milbert not only executed the original drawing, but also transferred it to the lithographic stone. This is one of the first American lithographs to suggest the potential of lithography as an artistic medium, not just a scientific curiosity. Barnett and Doolittle were not really interested in lithography, and their business only lasted a couple of years. In contrast, their successor in New York City, Anthony Imbert, was in business for more than 10 years and introduced and pioneered many of the uses that would come to characterize American lithography for years to come. Imbert's masterpiece is this book, The Grand Canal Celebration, published to celebrate the completion of the Erie Canal. The quality of the lithographs, many of them large folding plates based on Imbert's own compositions, is superb. They dramatically demonstrate just how effective lithographs could be when used as book illustrations. Many of Philadelphia's greatest lithographers would achieve their greatest success producing large color plates for books. Imbert also produced some of the first American examples of many other types of prints, including portraits, city views, and popular print forms such as cartoons and caricatures. A new map of the United States with the additional territories on an improved plan, exhibiting a view of the Rocky Mountains surveyed by a company of Winnebago Indians, was printed and published by Imbert in 1828. It's been called the first lithographic editorial cartoon published in America. Imbert went on to become one of the most prolific publishers of lithographic caricatures in the United States. His print, The Doctor's Puzzled or The Desperate Case of Mother U.S. Bank, is a satire on effects of Andrew Jackson's policies on the Second Bank of the United States, which of course was located here in Philadelphia. The style of this unsigned cartoon bears a strong resemblance to the work of the artist Edwards Williams Clay. Imbert also printed lithographs by Bass Otis and Henry Inman. By 1830, lithographic businesses were springing up all up and down the eastern seaboard of the United States. These included the firms of John and William Pendleton in Boston, Daniel Wright Kellogg in Hartford, Imbert in New York, and Cephas G. Childs in Philadelphia. The Pendleton brothers played a critical role in the introduction and spread of lithography. Harry Peters went so far as to say that these two brothers may almost be spoken of as the founders of American lithography. They were born in New York City and spent their early lives there. In 1818, they were in Philadelphia, installing gas lighting in Peale's Museum. And if you look in the left background of this famous self-portrait, you can actually see a couple of the gas lights hanging from the ceiling. Whoops, can we go back? In 1820, they were in charge of the highly successful traveling exhibition of Rembrandt Peale's painting, The Court of Death. John Pendleton subsequently went to France as a bookseller's agent, and it's there that he is said to have learned about lithography. However, it seems probable that he at least heard of the process during his time in Philadelphia. In 1825 or 1826, John and William Pendleton opened a lithography shop in Boston where they employed a French pressman whom John brought from Paris. They were joined there by Rembrandt Peale, who spent some time there, according to his own account, executing a number of portraits and other subjects, including this large portrait of George Washington, one of the earliest large portraits made in the United States. This lithograph received a silver medal from the Franklin Institute in Philadelphia in 1827. Also in Boston about this time was Daniel Wadsworth, the son of a wealthy merchant from Hartford, Connecticut, and a talented amateur artist. This 1807 portrait is by the Philadelphia portrait painter Thomas Selly. And Daniel would have been here in Philadelphia with his father, Jeremiah, who was very much involved with the American Revolution and with the Continental Congress. Several of Wadsworth's drawings were printed by the Pendletons, including his views of Rolling Dam Brook and part of the upper falls of the Genesee River in New York State, which were drawn on stone by the talented woman artist Catherine Scully. Some of Wadsworth's other drawings, such as this watercolor of part of Niagara Falls, you see the original drawing on the left and the lithograph on the right, were drawn on stone by William R. Brown and apparently printed by John Pendleton in New York after he opened a business there in 1830, following a short stint back in Philadelphia. A number of Wadsworth's drawings, all drawn on stone by Brown, were printed in New York and served as book illustrations. You can just see a couple of examples here. This map summarizes the activity of the Pendletons. John and William were in business together in Boston beginning in 1826, and William continued there alone after John departed in 1828. John went first to Philadelphia, then moved to New York City about a year later. In 1834, he would sell his New York shop to an up-and-coming competitor and former pupil, Nathaniel Currier. The Pendletons' most prominent pupils include Manvillette Elihu Deering Brown, who is understandably known as M.E.D. Brown. And you'll see at least one of his prints in the current show here. Brown opened a shop in Philadelphia in 1831, where Nathaniel Currier worked for a year before moving to New York. Daniel Wright Kellogg, who established his business in Hartford, Connecticut about 1830. FitzHenry Lane, who went on to a successful career as a marine painter while continuing to produce some really spectacular landscape lithographs. And Currier himself, who, as we've seen, worked briefly in Philadelphia before buying John Pendleton's shop in New York City and establishing his own business. Currier didn't form his famous partnership with James Merritt Ives until 1857.